when the Honorable Elijah Muhammad took wives from among the believing community, it was a secret. But why is it a secret? Because we have been a promiscuous people. Have we? Yes. Does the Bible call us an adulterous generation? Yes, sir. Have we been? Yes, sir. Are we still? Yes, sir. Are we disrespecters of women? Yes, sir. Did Elijah Muhammad teach us the value of a moral life? Yes, sir. Did he teach us one man, one woman? What does the Quran teach? Does the Quran teach that a Muslim man can have more than one wife? Talk to me. Yes, it does. Take up to four. But then the Quran says, one is better for you if you but knew. Now, some of the sisters say, I don't like that kind of teaching. I don't like that. Now, you was with me and I was with you up until you made that statement. Well, let's talk about it. How many of you sisters are like widows? You got children, but you have no man. The man that you thought you had has abandoned you. With babies, and you are there, eating yourself into bad health, looking at soap operas, wondering how life could be if you only had a good man. Wait, wait, wait. Elijah Muhammad knew that we had good potential, but we were a long way from being good men. He lived the life that he taught us until a certain time in his development, he took wives. Is this bad? Wait. Is it immoral? Is it evil? Is it ugly? Is it sin? Let's look at it. How many of you are acquainted with the Bible and the prophets' histories? How many wives did Abraham have? Come on, now let's talk now. Abraham, was he called the father of the righteous? Muslims, when we pray, do we mention Abraham's name?
Yes, sir.
Is Abraham not considered to us the father of the righteous? In the Christian tradition, is he not considered the friend of God? In the Jewish tradition, is he not considered the friend and the beloved of God? But he had two wives. One was called Sarah. Sarah wasn't able to produce any children at that time. Did Abraham go into Sarah's handmaiden, according to the Bible? What is a handmaiden? Talk to me. You know what a maiden is? A young woman, isn't it? A handmaiden, she was a servant of Abraham's wife. Did he have a child by that woman? She's called Hagar. Is that right? Come on, Muslims. Come on, Christians. Don't go to sleep now. We get into the juicy part. When that baby was produced, the Muslims say the baby's name is Ishmael. The Jews and the Christians from the Bible say his name is Isaac. We're not going to argue whether it's Ishmael or Isaac. We're just dealing with the principle a baby came into existence. And it wasn't Sarah's baby. Sarah got uptight, as you would expect. And Abraham put Hagar out of whose house? Out of his house. In the wilderness. Did he feed her out there? Talk to me. He didn't feed her. Did he clothe her out there? Did he shelter her out there? What was Hagar doing out there? She was running back and forth, seeking help for her and her baby from the hills. And every Muslim has to go back and forth between the Safa and the Marwa, retracing Hagar's path. Is that right? Why not Sarah's path? Why are you retracing Hagar's path? And why is Abraham considered a righteous man when he fathered a baby, according to the Bible, and put the woman out in the wilderness? Didn't live up to his quote-unquote responsibility. God was making Hagar a sign of a people who would be in the wilderness, running to and fro, looking for help, looking to the hills. That means governments to aid you, like you sitting around now waiting for Bill Clinton.
That's right.
To send you some bread. And Mr. Clinton went before Congress and said, there ain't no bread in the storehouse. We are nearly 4 trillion, 2 billion, $100 billion in debt. We got to raise taxes and cut federal spending. You heard him, didn't you? That means you can't go to Washington with your basket looking for some bread, because there ain't none there. Now, God put that on Hagar, so that Hagar would learn to rely on a power bigger than Abraham. And look at these black women out here with no man producing babies. And you wonder how these babies are getting fed. But every one of these sisters that got babies and no man, they know that God is real. Because the only way they could be here and their children grow is that a God fed them in the wilderness, just like God looked after Hagar in the wilderness. So now, if you were a contemporary of Abraham, how would you have judged Abraham? How many wives did Moses have? You can't even answer. You keep talking about Moses and Pharaoh. Do you know Moses had a domestic life? You don't even know how many wives he had, do you? That ain't interesting. Do you know when God chooses a prophet, he don't stop at the prophet? What does he choose? The seed of the prophet. If God finds favor with you, or you find favor with God, he's not only in love with you physically, he knows you're going away. He chooses you, and his covenant is not only with you, but with your offspring, your seed. Do you know that the seed of a prophet is chosen by God, and that seed is to be multiplied? Do you understand that? Why did the prophets have more than one wife? You can't find one prophet in the Bible that only had one wife. And there are even books out today that ask the question, was Jesus married? Because there are hints in the Bible that say that Jesus also was married. Did you know that Jesus had brothers and sisters? Spoken of in the book of Mark. How did he get brothers and sisters? What's that all about? We need to talk about that sometime. How many wives did Prophet Muhammad have? He had 9. Some scholars say he had 11, but God reduced the number to 9. Was Prophet Muhammad an evil man, a wicked man, a low-down man because he had wives? No. And the sad thing about this, Malcolm knew all of this. But as Malcolm grew in strength and power inside the nation, Malcolm attracted the envy and jealousy of many in the nation who were Malcolm's peers. They couldn't stand the fact that Malcolm was always talked about. And the way the press would write Malcolm up, they wrote Malcolm up as though Malcolm was the leader. And if you understand anything about leadership, a wise leader will always try a disciple, especially when the leader knows he's going away and he's going to leave a disciple in his seat. He's got to test that man to see will that man have the character to stand up to the rigors of the mission. You don't know Elijah. That's a very wise man. And any one of us that have ever been around him, he tested us all. Did he test us, Brother Sharif? Did he test us, Brother Emmanuel Muhammad? Did he try us? You would think that that man would sometimes ease up, but the closer you were to him, the more he tried you. And it seemed like the more people admired you, the more he tried you to see whether you would take the admiration and adulation of the people and use it someday against him. So the higher you got, the more your trials became. Isn't that the way it is in karate? When you're moving toward a black belt or a 10th degree or 8th degree or 7th degree, when you get way up, the harder the tests get because you're getting close to becoming a master. And you can't become a master unless you honor and respect the master who is making you a master. Now here I come. Malcolm learned that Elijah Muhammad had wives. He knew it at least a year before he defected from the nation. It hurt Malcolm, not the fact that there were wives, but it was deeper than that. The enmity, the jealousy inside the nation, and seeds being dropped that made Malcolm think that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad himself was jealous of Malcolm. Malcolm would do great things and he wouldn't get no writing in the Muhammad Speak newspaper. He was hurt behind that. Do you understand how when people work hard for a cause and they seem to get dissed by the people they work for, their heart begins to change? He always kept the Honorable Elijah Muhammad above and beyond that. But when Kennedy was assassinated and he made the statement, it was a case of the chickens coming home to roost, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad warned Malcolm and all of us as his ministers, say nothing with respect to the death of the president. Malcolm spoke in New York City. I think it was either the 5th or the 7th of December, 1963. And a man from the New York Times was sitting in the audience. No, I'm sorry. He came to the door and he was put out. And when Malcolm found out that Mr. Handler from the New York Times was sitting in the audience or trying to get in, Malcolm told Yusuf Shah to bring him back. That man sat in the audience. Malcolm obeyed his teacher and got through the lecture, but in a question and answer period, Malcolm said, "I'm never sad when chickens come home to roost. I'm happy when chickens come home to roost." And the next day, in the New York Times, and over the news, they played it up that Malcolm was mocking the death of the president. Elijah Muhammad, a wise teacher, silenced Malcolm. Said Malcolm was not speaking for himself or speaking for me. Malcolm was speaking for himself. And I have silenced Malcolm for 90 days. Now, any of you that know organization, I don't care how great you are, there has to be discipline in any organization in order for that organization to be effective. And the greater you are, the more you should be disciplined, because if you start straying away and there's nothing to bring you in line, pretty soon everybody will start messing up. So Malcolm had to be disciplined, but not just disciplined to teach Malcolm a lesson. to save Malcolm's life, to keep Malcolm out of the public while the people were angry as all get out that Malcolm would say such a thing over the death of a man as charismatic and as loved as John Fitzgerald Kennedy. But it was during that time that Malcolm was silenced. I was the brother that was called to New York to speak on that next Sunday in Malcolm's place. And after I spoke, Malcolm came to the mosque and picked me up and drove me to his house where I had dinner. Betty Shabazz fixed the dinner. Malcolm and I were sitting in the dining room by ourselves. And during the dinner, Malcolm told me about Elijah Muhammad's domestic life. And he asked me, after he told me that Elijah Muhammad had fathered these children, he said, "What do you think about it?" I said, "Brother, I think that there's no God but Allah, and Muhammad is his messenger." Malcolm took me to the airport, and these are the words he said to me. He said, "Brother Lewis," he said, "I wish that you wouldn't tell anybody what I said to you today." I said, "No, sir, I'm not going to tell anybody but the messenger." Now, Malcolm taught me how to respect the messenger. And when Malcolm deviated from the messenger, as much as I loved him, I could not walk with him because that man is the father of us all. And I looked at Malcolm as my brother, my friend, and my teacher, but don't go against our father. So the next morning, I'm back in Boston. Malcolm calls me at 5 a.m. time for prayer. And he said, "Brother, I wish you would give me some time so I can get a letter off to the messenger explaining why I said what I said to you." I said, "Well, brother, it's going to take me some time to get my head together to write him. So if in that time you can write him and explain yourself, you do that. But I don't want to get involved in no dispute between two powerful persons." He said, "Well, brother, there's only one powerful man, and that's the Honorable Elijah Muhammad." I said, "I'm aware of that. My wife sleeps. She don't know what's going on. I can't sleep because my head is messed up. You telling me that the fountainhead of my righteousness now has fathered children from some of the sisters. I'm upset." I get up and I sit down and I open my Quran. And I open the Holy Quran to the 33rd chapter. And I start reading, and it talks about the wives of Muhammad and how the missionaries called Muhammad a voluptuary. They started slandering him because of his wives. I called Malcolm back immediately and said, "Malcolm, I found something I gotta show you." He said, "Well, come on." At that time, you could go from Boston to New York for $14 on the airplane. I spent my last $28, got on the plane, and went to see Malcolm. Malcolm came, that same blue Oldsmobile that's at Malcolm X College. He came and we drove around. And I told Malcolm what I found in the Quran. And Malcolm's answer to me was, "I already know that, brother. But don't you say nothing about it because you frankly can't handle it. Let me handle that." I said, "Yes, sir." When Malcolm told me he knew that from the Quran, he knew how to defend the position of his teacher. But when, after the 90 days was up, the teacher put him out because he was going to various ministers telling them about the messenger's domestic life, that's when the messenger put him out. Anger sets in now. Now, if you watch Malcolm, he's angry with this man. Now, look at Malcolm. Try to get inside his shoes a minute. When the movie came out, a week later, CBS, did a thing on the real Malcolm, or the true Malcolm, right? How many of you saw it? You saw Malcolm X with Mike Wallace telling Mike Wallace the private life of his teacher. Now, wait a minute. If Malcolm loves Elijah Muhammad and loves black people, he knew you were not going to understand. Jesus said, there are many things I could tell you. You can't bear it now. If you don't have a foundation for certain knowledge, if that knowledge comes to you, it can destroy your faith. Malcolm is now angry. And when Malcolm gets on Cups and That Show, on Jerry Williams' show in Boston, Mike Wallace talking about the private life of Elijah Muhammad, every Muslim that loved Elijah Muhammad then began to hate Malcolm. You know why? Because that man is the fountain of our life. If you're going to attack that man in the public to destroy your ability to reason with the knowledge that God gave him for your salvation and mine, then we felt that Malcolm had become a traitor to that man and to you who are unborn. And there's not a Muslim that loved Elijah Muhammad that didn't want to kill Malcolm. Now listen to this. Malcolm's own work made every one of us a potential killer. Don't you know? I'm saying this today. There's a lot of people that love Farrakhan. And there's a lot that hate me too. But for some silly person to try to do me harm, when you see the good that I'm doing in transforming and reforming and inspiring black people to new levels of consciousness, but you would hate me because I believe that God came in the person of a man. Some of my Muslim brothers, I went to the Saudi embassy and I said in the presence of my son and my son-in-law, I said to them, I said, God has revealed to me that you are after my life. And I said, would you kill me because my interpretation of Quran and Islam is different from yours? Would you deprive my people of the last voice that they got that cannot be bought? Would you kill me and deprive my people of a voice? I said, I want you to know that them same little gangbangers that got all them guns, I said, many of them love Farrakhan. I said, I got an army that you see and a bigger army that you don't know nothing about. I said, listen, I'm telling you what I told them at the Saudi embassy. There's one thing I learned from Elijah Muhammad. You don't be a punk for nobody. You stand up like a man and tell the truth. Don't bow down to nothing or nobody but God. I told him, if anything happened to me and it's sponsored under you, our people will rise up and kill Muslims all over this country. Did you hear what I said? The same spirit that we had 30 years ago is the same spirit multiplied in the people today. I'm saying this to you. Every prophet had a community of zealots. Go read the history, brothers. And every prophet had a community of zealots that when you rose up against that prophet, the people would rise up and kill you. They could be a doorman, they could be a sweeper, they could be a blind person. It don't make any difference. When you hurt the prophet, the people say you must die. The messenger don't have to give no orders to kill you. We were already ordered to kill by the love that we had for the man that gave us life. Do you hear what I'm saying? I'm not no killer. But you mess with that man, and I become that. Because that man gave me life. That man taught me what I know. That man taught me how to eat, to live, that I could produce children of consequence. If you want to live, leave that man alone where we are concerned. When Malcolm stepped across that line, death was inevitable. Now, why did I say all that I said today? Betty Shabazz said that we killed Malcolm. I said, no. Betty, it was your husband's anger against his teacher that caused him to fight an institution. And every one of you that love Malcolm, you know that if Malcolm had the kind of character that you expect him to have, even if he disagreed with Elijah Muhammad, you see all the good that the man did, why would you go to the white man on your teacher because he had wives, when that same teacher took you from being a pimp, a hustler, a whoremaster, a dope user, and never threw that up in your face? This is the critical point. Elijah Muhammad was a man that could hide sex if that's what he wanted. Elijah Muhammad had money. He could have abortions like many people do. But he produced children. Why do you think he produced children? Because he know the flesh is passing away. He's chosen. He loves you. And he wants to produce children that would be lights of guidance and knowledge down into the generations. He loved me. And before he departed from us, he looked at me when my two daughters were marrying into his family. He sat on his bed and he looked up at me and said, I'm happy that your daughters are marrying my sons. I'm not going to go any further into that. I'll tell the sons what he said about them. And I'll tell my daughters what he said about them. And every word he said has come to pass. That man wanted our families to join, that we could become one family.
Yes, sir.
And we did become a family. Imam Waruthuddin Muhammad, the son of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, is a brilliant man. But he had a problem with his father's domestic life. And a son that has a love-hate relationship for a father and gets into leadership and power and then strikes the father. When the father's not here to defend himself, then this started breaking the nation up. I went to the imam, and the imam will tell you, I never spoke publicly against him. I always talked to him like a brother, like a man in private. I said, brother, leave your father alone. For the very foundation you're standing on is what your father built. You do what God put on you to do and leave what your father did to what he has done and let God be the judge. And when I could no longer abide seeing Elijah Muhammad and that man, Master Farag Muhammad, trashed. It's written in the Bible, Muslims, that the Messiah was going to be cut off. Elijah Muhammad stood in the mosque and said that one day hate will stand in this place. And hatred stood in that mosque on Stony Island and spoke evil words against Master Farad Muhammad and the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And it is the hatred that made the nation desolate. I didn't do this because I got courage. I stood back up to lift the name of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad up because I loved that man. And I did not want to see history write him out with all the good work that he did. His wives are here, some of them. I wanted you to see them. I want you to see women who are not cheap women, who are not low-life women. And I want you to meet some of the children that he produced for this generation. And it is the children who are the vindication that that man knew what he was doing, and God backed him in what he did.